Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us for our webinar today, the topic StageGate Maturity Model. My name is Michael Booker from StageGate International. Today's webinar will be approximately 25 to 30 minutes. We'll take question and answer via the chat function. They will privately come to me and we'll answer as many questions as we can and then follow up afterwards with any questions that we cannot address. Let me introduce you to Bernd Becker. Bernd is head of client services for all areas outside of North America and is currently in our location in Germany today, from which he will deliver today's topic. Bernd, without further ado, over to you. Thanks.
Thank you, Michael. Good morning and good afternoon to everybody on the line. Thanks for joining today. Hope you're safe and feeling good in these strange times. So today we want to take a look at the StageGate maturity model. So what is that maturity model? How was it developed? How can I apply it, or how does it apply to me? Let's take a look at these questions in the next 20 to 25 minutes. To understand the maturity model, we have to take a step in the past and take a look at the timeline, starting around 1980 when Dr. Robert Cooper and Dr. Scott Adger joined forces and they embarked on their journey of innovation management research. At a time like today, there were many companies that were hugely successful in the market and others struggled, although they had all the similar market conditions. So there must have been something else that supported success in some companies while others just couldn't make success really happen. Bob and Scott started to ask questions in this regard and of course soon were involved in many research studies. The deeper they dug, the more it became clear that companies that applied certain ways of decision-making had a much higher chance of success in the market. Now, in business, it's sadly many times the case that when something goes wrong, we just ask many questions like, why did it go wrong? What happened? Why didn't we achieve the desired results? And many times we try to pinpoint a person, a function, or even a customer for the lack of success. Bob and Scott on the other side looked at the positive side of things and looked at successful market launches and asked, what did you do right in order to make this a success? That perspective opened up a whole new dimension of answers and a whole new dimension of, and a whole new angle of analyzing success. So with those informations now in their mind, they developed the first generation of the StageGate process with focus on product leadership. That was around 1986. So we will look at each generation in more detail. So let me lay out the timeline first, and then let's look at the details. The books that you see here, by the way, are related to information that Bob and Scott discovered and cover many of the topics. So StageGate process, innovation strategy, portfolio management, ideation, and innovation leadership, for example. If you're interested, what books are available? Take a look at our website and you'll find them all listed there. So over the years, the research studies of Bob and Scott continued and they released the second generation of the StageGate process with focus on program leadership around 93. So never tired of finding out more evidence on best practices in innovation management, Bob and Scott then continued their research. And while adoption of StageGate grew to around 70% of CPG, FMG companies in the US, the third generation of StageGate with focus on portfolio leadership was released in 2002. So the journey continued then with adoption of StageGate growing rapidly between 2000 and 2010, with the fourth generation of StageGate with focus on strategic leadership was released in 2011. So in the past 10 to 15 years, the adoption of StageGate also grew rapidly in Europe and of course other parts of the world. And the fifth generation of StageGate was released in around 2018 with focus on transformation leadership. So to this point, it has been a journey of more than 35 years where we focused on research and solutions related to innovation management. Now, why did I lay this out? As you're certainly not listening in to learn about our history. Now, the reason is that you have to understand innovation as a journey that can give you quick results on one side, but can also take many years to show the desired impact. It took Bob and Scott and all of us at StageGate more than 3 decades to come from the first thoughts on best practices around innovation management to the deeper understanding of transformational leadership in innovation. And we are certainly not finished yet. So if someone asked you to read the latest book on StageGate and be ready to be perfect at it in a couple of months, manage those expectations carefully. The maturity model is just giving you the framework and inputs for the discussion. So how does that maturity model look like? When you look at the horizontal axis here on the chart, we look at the level of proficiency that you have in working with StageGate. On the left side, you have started experimenting, you're learning the technique. To the right, you're mastering the technique on different levels, and you're continuously improving it. On the vertical axis, of course, we have the 5 generations of StageGate listed. So what you get by these 2 axes is a chart that has increasing value and impact of your efforts on innovation management from the lower left to the upper right of the chart. In other words, on the lower third of the chart, it's all about project success. You are focusing on the process, on working on improving the technique. In the second third of the chart, you focus on portfolio success. You take a step back and you look at your overall combination of initiatives and to make the right decisions. And on the top third of the chart, you focus on the overall company success by integrating strategy and company transformation in your framework. So when I work with clients, I see many times the desire to be in the top right corner in just a short period of time. Of course, we as leaders have the desire to change quickly. Unfortunately, that doesn't work that easily. And it just takes a lot of change and effort to get to that top right corner. Think about it learning to ride a bike. You don't start with a racing bike or top of the line mountain bike when you start riding the bike. No, you start with a simple bike with not too many bells and whistles. You even start with training wheels just to make sure you don't hurt yourself. Then over time, you become used to the bike. The training wheels come off. You get more experience. And step by step, you move to the desired racing or mountain bike. Same in innovation. Take it one step at a time and always remember the journey.
Ernst, sometimes when I'm talking with clients, I get the question whether the later generations will be replaced with the earlier generations. How do you see that?
Thanks, Michael. That's a good question. I guess nowadays we are so trained by software updates that we would think, yes, the new iteration or generation is better and must replace the older version or generation. The answer is no. The StageGate model was expanded with each generation, not changed. That means it becomes more inclusive of different aspects of innovation management. So a generation one might work perfectly for one company, while another company needs generation three due to their business and organizational setup. We'll see that a little bit when we go through the different generation. Does that make sense, Michael?
Yeah, it does, Bernd. Thanks.
Okay. So now that we have laid the base, let's take a look at each of the generations. In our review, we look at these 3 aspects. What generation is it? What is it all about? What business impact can we achieve with this generation specifically? And which best management practice is emphasized in each generation? Again, remember the bicycle riding. In generation one, you wouldn't learn how to race down a mountain bike. You would learn how to stay on the bike and just keep the balance, right? So in generation one, it's all about a game plan for the stages and gates. It really is a minimum viable model of StageGate. All essential tools are there to be better at innovation management. The business impact we focus on is to improve the in-market success and then de-risk new product development. We want to make sure that the initiatives we invest in can be successful in the market. So instead of betting on investment upfront, we start making decisions gate by gate with increasing investments in the initiative. We look at critical success factors for each product, make sure we work cross-functionally, and we have gate metrics focused on commercial success. So all critical ingredients for success are already there. I have quite a few clients that work on that level, and they are hugely successful. That's all they need and all they want. But their journey has led them to this generation, and they're happy with that. So there's nothing wrong with that. Generation two, the training wheels come off in our analogy. We can now keep balance on our bike, and we know the basic maneuvers to stay out of trouble. So in generation two, it's all about looking at the process from a higher level. We don't just look at project success, we now look at success of programs, a series of projects that we run in parallel. We improve the time to profit and profitability of our overall programs, and we focus on speed to market by streamlining our process and ensuring we have the critical success factors for successful innovation in place. We have the six principles of Stagegate implemented, and we have a process design that's based on best practice of our research. So by looking at the programs instead of just projects, we now start to prioritize within our pipeline funnel, and we make sure that we have metrics in place that allow for continuous improvement. You can see a big step from generation one. I have clients that started here because they deal with many projects within a program. So they had to start their journey in generation two. Some others evolved and moved from generation one to generation two over a period of time. I guess by now you already get the point. It depends on your company, your situation, to determine where you start, where you are, or where you want to be in relation to this maturity model.
Thanks, Bernd. You mentioned the six principles. So just to recap so everybody's on the same page, could you quickly summarize those for us?
Oh, yes, of course, Michael. Good catch. So Stagegate is built on the six principles. We have principle number one, the optimization of the entire innovation process, not just the front end of or development, but all activities from ideation to launch. Number two principle is that we want to embrace risk by managing it. So we don't bet everything up front in a project, but break it down into the stages. In number three, we have the acceleration of the creative process. Within the stages, we enable multiple iterations of a product or service, creating options. Number four is then the gates, in which we have option-based decisions. We can go forward with a project, but we don't have to. Principle number five is visibility to performance, meaning that we have metrics in place that allow us to track process and status. Number six is a culture of accountability and discipline. So we have a learning organization that is empowered, but is also accountable. It would go a little bit too far off topic, Mike, to go into more details today. I'm sure we'll have a webinar at some point specifically on this topic. So just stay tuned on that. Does that answer the question, Michael?
Yeah, great, because those are key. Those are key as you explain the model.
Yeah, exactly. Thanks for catching that. So in generation three of our maturity model, we can now ride our bike in all situations, right? And we now have a bike for different requirements. We select a bike depending on what we want to do today. Same in generation three of our maturity model. We include now portfolio decisions in our innovation governance. So we not only make project and program decisions, we also take a look at our portfolio from time to time and make decisions on a higher level. The focus on these portfolio reviews is on return of investment in the portfolio, not just of return on investment project by project, but return on investment accumulated over all projects in our pipeline. And we increase productivity by prioritizing the right programs and projects to maximize productivity. By looking at the portfolio level, we now have also organizational level critical success factors in place. We look not only at products, but also look at culture and implement those critical success factors related to that. An important step is also that we start to apply right-sized processes to deal with the different kind of projects. So we use a simple Stagegate process for low-risk projects, and we use, for example, a five-stage process for highly risky projects to manage risk even further. In our portfolio reviews, we then use charts and metrics that are relevant to our company and to our vision, of course, so that we can make the right decisions. coming to generation 4, we now include our innovation strategy in our framework. Think about our bike experience. We are now really good at riding all kinds of bikes. But instead of selecting which one of our different bikes we use on an ad hoc basis, we think ahead and make a plan for ourselves. Monday and Tuesday, street bike day. Wednesday to Friday, racing bike. And Saturday, Sunday, we want to have fun and we take the mountain bike out to the woods. So our plan is based on what we want to achieve as a biker, maybe a mix of regular application, speed and fun. Same in our innovation framework. We have a strategy in place which guides us in our innovation. We look at the overall return on investment of all of our innovation efforts, and we tie that to the strategy and the direction we want to take the company. It's all about a shared innovation vision. So we as leaders have to align on the innovation and technology strategy. We have all elements of the StageGate innovation performance framework in place, which are strategy, portfolio management, idea to launch process, and culture leadership. But as an organization, we have an idea capturing system in place that encourages open collaboration internally and externally. So we look beyond company boundaries. The metrics we use focus now at delivering our strategy versus delivering on individual projects or programs. To be honest, not too many of my clients are at this level, nor do they need to be. The ones that are on this level have decided that the strategy is their main driver for their innovation efforts. Of course, other companies also have strategies in place, but most often they don't relate to their strategy when it comes to innovation planning. Again, it can work, but depends on what your vision for your company is. Wow, already a generation 5. You see how fast you can go through 35 years of research? So this generation is all about company transformation. In our bike analogy, we now transform ourselves each time we meet a new challenge. We are great at mountain biking, for example. We can ride all of our trails in our woods in our area. Now we face a challenge to do a ride in the Rockies. Steep cliffs, rocks all over the place. Nothing like our woods at home. But instead of saying no, we start to practice. We get advice. We learn new skills in handling our bike, and we get ready for that new ride in the Rockies. Why do we do that? We try to de-risk the adventure. Instead of just doing that new ride without any preparation, we transform ourselves from a casual woods rider to a serious Rocky Mountain biker. It's a truly transformative change, one challenge at a time. I'll show you an example of a company that is on that level in a short while. So in generation 5, it's all about the continuous innovation organization. Every time we take on a new challenge, get the organization ready by gaining new skills and experience, we change our mindset from, well, we have our process ready, let's apply it and get this done. And we change it to, how can we apply the knowledge in our process to adapt to this challenge quickly, and how can we apply this best to grow our company? So it's a whole new dimension of mindset that comes into play. Believe me when I say the journey to this generation is long and takes lots of effort. And quite frankly, it takes stubbornness to get done. Stubbornness because there are so many temptations on the way to just go the easy way, not take on that new challenge, and just feel comfortable with where we are. We all know that feeling, I'm sure. But if you get to this level, it just feels so different and rewarding. Okay, 5 levels, 5 generations. How can we now apply this model to develop a vision for your company? How can this help you manage expectations? As always, in innovation, there are options. Let's say your company has assessed that you stand at this level. You are at the generation 2 process enabling, and you have some experience at what you're doing on that level. You can now say, I want to be really good at what I'm doing and master all the details of that level. And when I'm done with that, I'll move up to the next generation and really get good at that. Or you say, let's not waste time in just getting good at what we are doing today. But let's include the techniques and knowledge of the new level right away. And then let's get good at it. Either way works. I've worked with clients in both scenarios and both work. It all depends on the culture in your company and how the organization learns best. Important is, either way you do it, you will need a roadmap, a business case, and an implementation plan to get this done. These three ingredients for your plan will help you develop the vision, manage the expectations, show the benefits of your plan, and then manage the implementation of the change.
Bernd, a question that often comes up regarding the roadmap and where clients sometimes struggle is assessing the starting point. What advice could you give to our listeners in that regard to find out where they stand? How should they start?
Okay, thanks, Michael. Well, that's truly a tough question. And to my experience, that's really the hardest part. It's at the beginning, assessing where you stand as a company. So the moment you start asking questions to find out where you stand, you will get different opinions with all good explanations, of course. Some people think you're really good at certain things you do, while others think that there is a lot of room for improvement in exactly those things. In order not to hold up process, what I typically do with my clients sometimes is to define their ideal innovation governance scenario first. Then we go backwards and determine the actual situation guided by that vision they have for the ideal scenario. In essence, we develop a paradigm shift document that shows where they stand today and how that should look like tomorrow. We just do it backwards. Either way is fine. It's, however, important that you determine where you stand today. Don't skip that step. Otherwise, it's very hard to come up with a roadmap, a communication plan to achieve buy-in by the organization to the change, and a business case. And of course, we cannot track progress if we don't know where we start. And this is many times where we come in, actually, from StageGate International and help channel and focus that discussion based on the proven aspects and questions that we have developed over the years. That certainly cuts down the time for your roadmap and business plan significantly and advances your vision at the same time. Make sense, Michael?
Yeah, it does, Bernd. It does.
Thanks for asking. So you can imagine the change requirements from generation to generation increase significantly. Just to get to generation is sometimes a significant change to a company if the company had no real process in place before and is now asked to follow certain steps to move projects forward. Moving up from there is a major change management project. So while you develop the process and governance for each level, place a lot of effort on the change management side of this initiative as well. It will help you to be more successful. So now that we have covered the five generations of StageGate, and as I promised, here's an example of a company that is really living this transformational change as we speak. It is Corning. The company built a business in 1879, many years ago, around light bulbs, introduced a mass production process for these and helped make Edison's electric lamp affordable for the masses. Over the next three decades, the company moved to different products and had, in 1913, a line of cookware products in the market. What a change, light bulbs to cookware. Another two decades later, Corning was a producer of a 200-inch mirror for the telescope at Mount Palomar in Southern California. Big change. And for those that remember this, they went on to TV tubes, which were launched in 1947. And as you can see, they went through different types of product categories over the next 70 years to become the key supplier of the glass that is on most of our smartphones today. Just look at the products on this slide. Yes, it spans a long time, but look at the completely different types of products. Can you imagine how much change was required each time they ventured into these new product markets? New markets to learn, new technologies to master, new skills to learn and apply. Corning is very methodical when it comes to these transformational changes. They apply StageGate for their decision-making and for guiding them in the right direction based on their overall strategy. You can read a lot more about this on their website, actually. We could cover hours on this topic, going into detail on each of the generation, but given the time, let's take some time to answer your questions. Michael, did we receive
Yes, thanks. Some? Yeah, thanks, Bernd. First of all, we've had a couple of chats come in regarding the content. Yes, it will be provided to you shortly after today's presentation, so thank you for that. Question regarding relevant KPI metrics. Bernd, can you tell me more about setting relevant KPI metrics for innovation portfolios? And a couple of examples, if you could. Thanks.
So to clarify, we are talking portfolio level generation 3, what I hear.
Yes, so, KPI metrics for innovation portfolios.
Okay. So first of all, there are some metrics that you always wanna track when you talk about portfolio. But before I go into that, always keep in mind the KPIs that you have that you wanna track, they have to fit your organization and they have to fit the vision that you have, right? It doesn't help when you track KPIs to achieve innovation success in a certain market and then you track market growth in just another market. That doesn't help you. So you have to be very careful what KPIs you track. Typical KPIs for portfolio is the overall value of your portfolio, right? The dollar value. How much value do all the projects in your pipeline have in terms of portfolio? Is it $1 million? Is it 10, 50, 100 million? You want to track that. Another KPI would be the time. When do all these revenues come in? So where do your projects stand? Stage 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, maybe. And then, of course, you track cost, you track profits. There are, as I said, many KPIs that you can track. And when you go on our website or when you look at some of our books, you'll find a lot of examples about this. We have had a webinar, by the way, about 4 weeks ago about KPIs on pipeline management. So you may want to just take a look at that webinar for 30 minutes and you will get some more answers on that. Hope that helps.
Thanks, Bernd. Any more questions from folks in the chat function? We got another minute or so. And if not, Bernd, thank you. Over to you for concluding remarks.
Okay. Thank you, Michael. We are right on time. So let's take quickly a look at the services we offer in regards to this maturity model. As mentioned earlier, we can help you in the development of your roadmap, the business case, and the implementation plan. We work with you to assess where your starting point is, as we discussed, and we develop the vision and implementation plan with you. When you find yourself at a point where you master the practice in one of the generation and you want to move up to a new generation, we can help you with designing your new process and process governance to include what works best of your current process and then advance the new generation process seamlessly. And third, when you want to get better within your current generation of the model, we can support you with workshops and training for gatekeepers and practitioners. Always, of course, customized to your actual situation. So if you have any interest in one of these services, send us an email and we'll fill you in with more details. So at this point, we're at the end of the webinar. You'll receive the slides, as Michael said, of the webinar shortly. Right after the end, we'll send you a quick survey. It takes a minute to fill out. Do us a favor, fill it out. It helps us targeting the content for future sessions. Thank you for taking the time to participate and listen in. Our next webinar is scheduled for Tuesday, June 2nd at 10 a.m. Eastern Time, and we'll send out more information through our newsletter in the coming days. All the best, stay safe, and have a great week. Bye.